I might say that this report, as its title indicates, is looking ahead, trying desperately to figure out what is the potential in the future, and particularly in 2050, as to whether or not it would be possible to have 80% of energy supply for China coming from the renewable sector. As we know, China has already launched very significant efforts to develop the industry and the utilization of renewable energy in China. It's very fast growing, and indeed it's very much in this country as well. But this report is very similar to one that came out in 2012 about the United States, done by our government laboratory, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory here in the United States, which also looked at whether or not you can make 80% by 2050. And I think both reports conclude that certainly technically you can do that. We all know there are many hurdles to ever getting to those high numbers, but the point is that these are kinds of things we can begin looking toward and seeing whether or not there are ways that we can help address the climate issue that is one of the imperatives of our generation. Well, I'm going to turn this over to Dr. Joanna Lewis from Georgetown University. She is an associate professor there of science technology, and she is in international affairs. She is one of the lead authors from the IPCC, the fifth assessment, and we at RFF had a couple of lead authors as well, and this, of course, is the United Nations effort to bring together all the research around the world and figure out where we are in terms of the climate and the effort to curb emissions or adapt to the changing climate. In addition, she has done extensive work in a variety of ways with respect to energy and environmental issues in China. And most recently, she's had a book called Green Innovation in China. So I will turn it over to her to introduce our guests, and you have at your seats fuller biographies of all of the folks you're going to hear from today. Dr. Lewis.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming this morning, and thank you in particular to RFF for hosting this event. We are going to start off this morning with two presentations, and then we'll move into a plenary discussion and open it up for questions. I wanted to introduce the three speakers who are with us this morning, starting with Wang Zhongying, who is the director of the China National Renewable Energy Center and the deputy director general of the Energy Research Institute of the National Development and Reform Commission of China. Wang Zhongying was also the lead, the director of this project, of the report that we'll be presenting here this morning. We are also joined by Li Zhenfeng, the director general of the National Center for Climate Change Strategy and International Cooperation of the National Development and Reform Commission. And Li Zhenfeng is here this morning to put this study in particular in the broader context of policy discussions happening in China on climate change and the transition to low-carbon energy sources. And finally, we are also joined by Samuel Baldwin, who's the Chief Science Officer of the Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy at the U.S. Department of Energy. We're excited to have Sam here this morning in particular because he was the lead of the similar study that the U.S. Conducted, which was just mentioned, the 2012 Renewable Electricity Future Study by the U.S. Department of Energy and the National Renewable Energy Laboratory. This study really, I think, served as sort of the model and inspiration for this Chinese study, so it'll be great to have him here to put this more in the U.S. context. So with that, don't want to waste any more time and turn this directly over to our presenters this morning. We're going to start with Li Zhenfeng. Dr. Li, if you'd like to come up.
Okay. I do not prepare any PPT, but let's say a few words. First of all, to make some congratulations for Yang Ai. It's my first job when I graduate from university, and I studied Yang Ai for more than 30 years, and I congratulations for an energy foundation to support AI, make such good job for example, the kind of long penetration of renewables by 2050. I give a short kind of policy background why China needed renewables. As you know already, it's the last year, in the middle of the November, the two presidents of USA and China make a joint statement. The USA was a target, forget it. But for China, target is very clear. So, China should be take about 20, it should be not by, it should be around 2030 to be the carbon emission be peak time. Also 20% by non-fossil fuels in the total energy consumptions. Both of them is a big challenge for China, not only for the Chinese government, also for all the participants. As you know already, in the past kind of 30 years, after the opening and the reform of economic system, China economy is very fast kind of growth. It's the annual the kind of GDP growth rate is around 9 to 10%. Meanwhile, the energy consumption also increased very fast. By the end of 2014, this means last year, the total consumption of energy reached 4.2 billion the kind of tons of coal equivalent. This means about near 3 billion tons of TOE, tons of oil equivalent. But I couldn't convert it kind of BTU. The USA people always convert it to BTU. But I say that it's one third higher than the USA energy consumptions. However, China faces very difficult situation, not only for the kind of GHG emissions, but also for kind of pollution control, especially air pollution problems. Beijing and around Beijing, even like Shanghai, even like Guangdong, we have a serious problem for the kind of air pollution issues. So everybody and from China to come to USA, first things take their camera or their mobile phone to take pictures for the blue sky. The blue sky is one of the happiness for the Beijing people. It is. So that means by the kind of fossil fuel energy consumptions, we face double pressures. One of the kind of GHG, another one is the air pollution control. So the Chinese government take a serious kind of steps. They try to make changes in the next 5 years. That means by 2020, the air quality should get better. They couldn't totally solve the problem, but they try to get better. Like 20 to 30%, the kind of reductions for the kind of PM2.5 and other air polluting. But for GHG is another big topic. Both of them, they need renewables. That's why I'm very appreciate for such kind of study. They give the kind of right directions in the within about 30 or 35 years. China can no longer always, usually, it's always depend on coal, but no longer China rely on coal. By that time, maybe less than 30%. That's the average of coal dependence in the world. However, if take Chinese factors, the whole world, only less than 20% energy depend on coal. It's like 17 to 19%. You plus China is 30, 31. Well, I take this one as 30%, maybe by 2050, China can less depend on coal compared with today. So we hope we are really can reach the target. I knew that this does the picture. We need a big effort. We need a lot of reform. include kind of power sector reform, as Mr. Liu lead on that, in the RC, I mean, leading on that for the power sector reform. We also need, that means we need a power sector reform, that means we need give renewable energy, special renewable for power, enough demand space. That's very important. Another one, we need a lot of reform for the kind of financing reform, not only in China, also in the worldwide. Financing reform is important to support renewables. Since all the renewables, the cost, 70% to 80% is the financing cost. If we with very high financing cost, that should be with very high cost for PV and solar. I take solar as an example. If we take like $1,000 per kilowatt, if based on the USA interest rate is about 2%, that means each kilowatt hours only maybe $2. If take current Chinese bank loan interest rate is about 8 to 10%. That means like $8 to $10. That's the difference. So we need the kind of reform for financing reform. Also, we need the kind of technical innovations. For renewables, there are really lot of emissions. You can think of that. When I was young, that during that time, the PV is per watt, not per kilowatt, per watt, is more than $10. But now it's less than $1, of course. Much less than $1. That's the 30 years. I think another 30 years later, the technical innovations creating a lot of the kind of future for us. So for this target, we need work together. Especially, we hope, USA and China, two big countries, both big economy, big population, big energy market, and also big renewable energy market. We need to work together and try to give the world is a kind of really good future. You know, 30 years ago, when I was young, I traveled to USA, we learned quite a lot from USA. I said, US today, the USA is the tomorrow of China. Now I think today and tomorrow's China, I mean the energy solution, should be give good example for the world. If China can solve their problem for energy in a sustainable way, and another country certainly can follow it. This 1.3 billion population, one third more energy used than USA. If they can solve the energy problem by the 2050, and worldwide is no problem. So for this dream, we need to work together. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker will be Wang Zhongying, who is going to present a summary of the report, which we are launching today, the China 2050 High Renewable Energy Penetration Scenario and Roadmap Study. This is a mouthful, but I think it's important to note that this is a study which really has been a multi-year effort involving many organizations which are extremely, not only leading researchers in China, but very influential in shaping the policy conversation. So, Dr. Wang.
Good morning, everybody. I'm very happy I can stand here, give everybody the presentation about China 2050's picture about the energy strategy. So China 2050 High Renewable Energy Penetration Scenario and the Roadmap Study, we started 3 years ago. 3 years ago. we're preparing 1 year for this work, and we calculate and the modeling analysis. We spend almost 2 years. Today we have the, we cannot say the final result. In China, we have the release, this is the results, release the report. We said, we just start. We just start. So this is a project under the support of the Energy Foundation and cooperated with China, how to say, very strong partnerships. So I show you the co-working group here. Now, firstly, I give everybody very simply a background about our study. Then we'll introduce the conclusions of our report, because everybody have this brochure in hand. So conclusion, I just very flash the introduction to you. Then I want to talk some our understanding why our study is reasonable. So high renewable energy penetration is driven by the scenario. What's the scenario? Everybody knows the beautiful China dream. That's what we say. The China dream includes the economic dream and the ecological dream. And in addition, we also can should consider the global energy development trends. Non-fossil fuel is the main direction. So that's why we have a high renewable energy penetration scenario. But focus on China, what's the economic dream? Our leader, central government, makes the decision, the strategy, they said, two hundred dreams. Second 100 years dreams is by 2049, when we establish our, when the China, because the People Republic of China started 1949. So by the 2049, our economic level should reach the middle level of developed the countries in 2025. This is the first economic. But just Mr. Li mentioned, so far we face the serious the environment issues in China. Everybody, if you go to the Beijing, when you go outside, you can find the very serious smoke pollution. So ecological environment is another dream. We want to reback 1980s China's environment situations. That's a blue air, blue skies, and clean water. This is that also could say that our analysis boundary, economic boundary and the environment boundary. The third one about the energy fossil fuel emissions, low carbon and green electricity. This is our objective for our energy development for futures. So we also established the very serious the boundaries for 2050 CO2 emission and other polluter emissions, include SO2, NOx, and other heavy metal emissions. So this is our scenario driven, also is our boundary. So economic development. By 2050, the China's GDP will be the 7 times of 2010. This is both of the our goals for 11 development, also is our macroeconomic boundary. We must reach these goals. About the ecological environment, what's the 2050? So just before I said our assumption, all pollutant emissions should reduce to the 1980s level of China emission level. So CO2 emissions by 2050 per capita will reach the 2 tons per capita. That's almost the one half of 1990 world average level. World average level, that is 3.99 per capita tons, 1990, the world average level. So this is to show you our pollution, how reducing trends. So this is I show you the 1990 and 2010 the level of global average emission for CO2. Now go to the main calculated results for high renewable energy penetration. How high for these studies? The first is about the rate of electrification to be higher than 60% of the end user energy consumption. That's a very important element for this study. If our electrification rate cannot reach this level, our energy system cannot have the very high efficiencies. This is very important. The second, about the whole electricities, renewable electricity will be account of 86%. If we include the nuclear power, the will be non-fossil fuel electricity will account of total electricity supply 91%. About the primary energies, according to our, we use the thermal value calculations. By 2050, in China, we only use 3.4 billion tons of coal equivalent tons. We can meet our economic development demands. No problem. Now, I go to our 10 conclusions or 10 thinkings for our this study. I think everybody could believe why we can use the so few primary energy can meet our huge economic development. I will be quickly for this. First, the conclusion is by 2050, total primary energy supply, renewable energy could be accounted at least 60%. Because the brochure has the detail, so I don't know that. The second about the emission peak and fossil fuel emission peak and fossil fuel consumption peak and the CO2 emission peak. Before the 25, if we take the high renewable energy penetration strategy, we can reach the CO2 emission peak. And by 2020, our coal consumption, we can reach the peak. Sorry. This is the carbon. This is coal, this is the CO2. The third one, renewable electricity will take the key role for the energy strategies. By the 2050, I mentioned electricity from the renewable energy will be account of 86%. But in the electricities, renewable electricity, wind and solar will be take the key roles. This is a figure show you the our studies, roadmap study for wind and solar power, PV, solar PV, solar thermal, includes solar PV and solar thermal. What's the development strength? Before the 2025, little bit slow. After 2025, between the 2040, that will be very quickly speed the development for the wind and the solar. For example, by 2030, maybe in 1 year, not maybe, in 1 year, we can increase the 100 million kilowatt the capacity for wind. No problem. Then after the 2040, wind and solar will be again slowly, because our economic also very speed will be reduced, will be the slowly. This is the fourth about the high electrification rate bring human society into more high level of civilized information. That's the meanings in building, industry, transportation, even people's daily cooking, everything, mainly we will depend on the electricities. That's the meanings energy system, high efficiencies. Energy consumption makes the everything clean. Another conclusion is about the transmission line. In our study, transform the electricity transmission network to a platform for optimized resource allocations. What means that the solar and wind resource distribution not balanced. How optimizes use this resource and how transmit this? We do a lot of simulations. Use our models. This is just the very simply simulated our grid from the 2011 to 2030, 2050. Another very important conclusion is technical and institution innovation is the foundation to build a high renewable energy penetration power system. The market role is very strong. But the time, I don't give the detailed introduction. I just give the examples. Just last month, solar carved in Germany, that's a very, very smoothly, they know anything to happen. The TSO prepare a lot of measures, but almost no measures take a role because they throw the market. In Germany, there are 800 distributors and electricity suppliers. They through the market resolve the solar cap issues. So simply says about another conclusion about the electricity system and the cost. We do a calculate, analyze. This is the kilowatt hour the cost development trend in high penetration scenario. The ninth conclusion is about the economic influence. For this is the map, I just take the two events to explain how the scenario is reasonable. One is the macro influence. Second, about the job. If you for renewable energy, we can provide the more jobs. Everybody knows so far in China, the energy depends on the coal power, oil and gas. Only the coal mine, coal power, oil, both of this is the fossil fuel industries, not include the manufacturers. The total job provides the almost 12 million jobs. But in future, our renewable energy industry, we also can provide 12 million jobs, no problem. The last conclusion is about the environment. So high renewable energy penetration will help bring back the clear water and the blue skies. Okay, spend too much time for this conclusion. Give me another 5 minutes. I explain our study is reasonable. Economic issues is everybody concerned for renewable energy development. Everybody says the renewable energy, wind power, solar PV, the cost too high. I don't think so. Even China and Germany give a subsidy to the wind and the solar PV, but the coal fire plant, what's the real cost of a coal fire plant? No anybody calculate the smoke issues, pollution issues, but in future, we think. If we do planning, we should consider the social cost. We should include the environment cost, environment evaluations. So, from my own view, the biggest challenge for renewable energy development, not economic issues, is the technical issues. Variability of renewable energy. This is a big challenges. When we have wind, we have electricity. When we have sun, we have electricity. No wind, no sun, no electricity. So why we say our scenario is reasonable? This is a concept. Achieve a high level dynamic stability. Through the changes, what meanings? Supply side, everybody know that is the changes variable, wind, solar variable. But I should mention everybody, demand side also changed. You don't know what time you turn on light, you turn off light, you turn on your machine, you turn off your machine, your air condition, everything. You want producing, you can start. So demand side variable, and this variable you cannot forecast. you cannot forecast. So how make the stability and the reliability for the electricity system? We know intelligence, smart, flexibility, these are the two very important things. How make the two events take the function? We can through the communication internet, energy internet, things internet. We say three internet integration, we can solve the issues. Why? Don't forget electricity transmission speed is same as the line, light, very quickly. So supply side change, you can get the response. Demand side change, you also can get the response. So I go to the detail about this. Variable demand, variable generation. Demand side flexibility, could be flexibility. No problem. Flexible generation union, so far in US and in the world, smart grid, they focus on the and the user how flexibility, demand how flexibility, and the supply how flexibility. So smart control and very strong, powerful market, real-time price or dynamic price could solve these issues, just like the Germany's the solar carbon issues. No problem. Then in our study, we do the very important the simulation and analyze use the electricity vehicles. In future, we think electricity vehicle could give the big contribution for power system stability, reliability. This is the EV. And also, new business, the model of the electricity vehicle will change the concept of power dispatch. So this is our concrete case study for Beijing case studies. We give the assumption about the Beijing in future 2030. Total car accumulation will be the 500 million. No. 100 million. Eh? 1 million. Eh? 1,000. 10 million, sorry. So far in Beijing, there are 6 million cars. By 2030, 10 million. If the 10 million cars, half of them, 5 million electricity vehicle, even each vehicle continues the miles, continues the kilometers, 200 kilometers. That's the 200 kilometers. That means the electricity vehicle could storage 40 kilowatt hours. Store 40 kilowatt hours. In Beijing, no peak, no. That's the electricity load will be flat. If our electric vehicle could reach the level of Tesla's levels, 500 kilometers, that means storage is 85 kilowatt hours. We don't need 5 million electric vehicles. 2 million electric vehicles, the Beijing electricity load will be stable. This is one case support our the scenarios. The second, everybody know in China, there are huge coal-fired plants. But all of these coal-fired plants established after the 20,000 years. All of the coal-fired plants could continue to work in the 5 years, no problem. We just changed some of the special parts. How we use this coal-fired plant? We can reduce their running hours. So in our studies, we do some simultaneous. By 2050, our will still keep the almost 8.8 100 gigawatts coal-fired plant, but running hours around 1,000 hours. Everybody, I don't know whether everybody knows that in China, so far the coal-fired plant is running hours almost 5,000 hours. 5,000. So that means the technical innovation for coal-fired plant, they can take the peak dispatcher functions. So that will be very, very important components for support our power electricity stabilities. So this is our hourly dispatcher on a typical day in high penetration scenario, one day of 2015. So last about the action, I don't have time to explain. I just how make decision our action plans. We have five principles. First, our high renewable energy penetration based on market oriented. Second, economically viable. The third, consider both long-term and the near-term. What's the meaning? Why we want to do the 2050 study? We want to influence government 13th 5-year plan and the 2030 energy strategy decisions. So the fourth one, soft and hard support. The last one benefits the whole society. So high renewable energy penetration, that is a non-zero sum things. So about action plan, everybody can see the brochure. So last, I don't repeat these famous words. I just want to, we hope our study can influence the government's 13 5-year plan and 2030 energy strategies. That's very important. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. I'd now like to invite all the panelists to please join me on the stage here so we can have a discussion. I want to thank both of the presenters for, I think, a really interesting presentation. First, Li Junfeng for putting the report in the broader context of the current policy decisions which China is currently making, and Director Wang for presenting the overview of the report. And of course, you have in front of you the summary. We will be posting a longer version of the executive summary of the report online for those of you who are interested in seeing more details of the final report. I'd like to start off by asking a few questions of our panelists, maybe beginning with Sam Baldwin. You know, I think it's really interesting to hear, particularly sitting here in Washington, what China could potentially do in terms of this visionary scenario for high penetration renewables. I know the U.S., led by the Department of Energy, has done similar studies, and it might be useful for this audience if you could speak a bit about those studies and, you know, potentially how useful you think they've been, particularly for sort of policymakers and the broader thinking about the role of renewables in the United States.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, it's very exciting to see this study of China, and I'm eager to see the details of it. A tremendous amount of hard work, but really opens up enormous opportunities. For the U.S., we've done a number of studies. Just a couple of weeks ago, we looked at a wind vision report going out to 2030, looking at 20% of all energy in the U.S., all electricity in the U.S. coming from wind by the year 2030. We've also done a broader set of studies. And so the one that was referred to earlier, the Renewable Electricity Futures Study, what we did in that was to look at, can the U.S. get 80% of all its electricity from renewable energy? And when we started it, the attitude was that, you know, that's crazy. You know, you can't do that because wind is variable, and so the system won't even work, was the attitude. And that, you know, whatever you do, the cost is going to go through the roof. And so we explored that. We asked the question of, can you do 80% of all power coming from renewables? And in fact, we didn't even start with the 80% goal. We said, how far can we push it? And at what point does the system stop working? At what point do costs go through the roof? And so we started out, we'd done the wind 20% study. So we started out 30%, 40%, 50%, and we walked up. We kept expecting things to fall apart. They never did. We went all the way up to 90%, and nothing fell apart. In fact, what you have are synergies. Wind blows more at night, solar during the day, you have hydro, you have biomass, and together they can make the system work. It's more challenging in some ways than the conventional system. You have to have more units operating and working to fill in the variability, but you can make it work. And we ran it even with commercial utility software at the hourly level for the entire continental United States, and we still got 80% of all power coming from renewables. Now, in terms of cost, we were worried that, gee, the cost would explode. Well, in fact, it didn't. We saw that it just gradually increased, even with you know, current 2010 levels of technology frozen in. And then we looked at very conservative cases. We recently updated the study this last spring, a year ago. We looked at current Department of Energy targets and were ahead of schedule in many of these. And what we found was for a baseline using EIA annual energy outlook projections of works out to be about 11 cents a kilowatt hour across the United States, that the 80% renewables case with current DOE targets for the technologies in the 2020-2025 period, the renewables case came in about 11.4 cents a kilowatt hour. So a very, very small difference in cost. And that reduces the demand for natural gas, which reduces the cost of natural gas, which saves money in other sectors of the economy. So bottom line is, you know, within the U.S. studies, you can do this. And at the operational level, and the costs are quite reasonable. And so the end result is that many of the myths that have been out there about renewables, it takes work, but we can do it. And it's being increasingly reflected in actual goal setting by various programs across the US. Canada now has a 50% target for renewables. And you can see it operationally in different places. California has had several days in the past year where they ran 40% of all power coming from renewables. Portugal is running more like 70%. Ireland has had over 60%. And so you can see increasingly that not only do these models show that it's possible, but the actual experience on the ground makes it possible.
Great, thank you very much. Director Wang, I wonder if you could speak a bit about what you perceive to be some of the challenges in implementing this visionary scenario, which you presented for 2050, achieving, you know, renewables representing over 60% of primary energy and over 80% of electricity. Do you think the main challenges will be technical, will be institutional? What do you see as some of the challenges for China to address in the near term?
For all this 2050 studies, the big challenges that could be said, how to say, in China, electricity institution. In China, from my own view, in China so far, we have no electricity market. In our studies, we have assumptions. By 2025, China must establish a completely competing electricity market. If by 2025, cannot establish this is a market, electricity market. No hope for our the studies. So we need 10 years. Next 10 years, that's very important for China. This is one of very important things. The second about the emission. So for China, the government very gave the big attention about electricity vehicle. But in fact, electricity vehicle industry, not good. How to say? Not very good the results already. I think in next 5 years, even the 10 years, how combine the electric market establishment to develop the China electricity vehicle industries, and also very important.
Great. Thank you very much. Well, finally, I wonder, Director General Li, where you sit in the main think tank that advises the government on climate change policy. Of course, renewable energy is going to play a very important role in the low carbon transition in China. I wonder if you could speak a bit to what extent you see renewables playing an important role in the peaking of carbon emissions in China, what this study might tell you about the timing of such peaks and the role in reducing coal use as well.
That's a very difficult question, since after the Trump president making a joint statement, everybody asked me such questions. if China can reach the peak time before 2030, I said that is the English version is translated by the White House. I think the White House people is with very bad kind of English translation. It's in Chinese, it means 2030年左右. Then the White House translate is by 2030. Even my English is very poor, but it should around 2030 instead of by 2030. So they make a mistake. Everybody should be, they say, as early as possible. That means certainly before the 2030. I'm not sure. The Chinese words is around the 2030. It's the earlier the better, but based on the following the kind of instructions. Number one, it should be following the Chinese sustainable development requirement. That's no doubt, since China want to be one of the members of the developed country by 2050, that's the first priority. The rest is that should be the second hand, the third level, the kind of requirement is number one. So number two is also rely on the transition timing for the kind of economic the innovations. Without the kind of economic transfer from the kind of high, the kind of heavy chemical industries and as the majority of the economy transfer to the low carbon economy, otherwise it's hopeless to reach the peak time. The third one is the transition to the low carbon energy. Without the low carbon energy, you couldn't reach the kind of peak time at all. The best way, we don't know, I don't think the earlier the better, we should be to calculate the less the better of the kind of total emissions, accumulations. That means we should have better kind of environmental requirement and a better kind of energy structure and a better economy. So that's the China, if China can reach what kind of peak, how high and how long, it's mostly that depend on the two things. Number one is the economic reform. Another one, energy revolutions, especially for the renewables. Since the rest is already to be fixed, for example, how much hydro is already, nothing more than the kind of 400 gigawatt. Nuclear is almost fixed, no more than like I'm not sure, it's 130, 150 gigawatt. That's the maximum. And so only wind and solar have very big the kind of, you can make a dream at least. The rest, even you couldn't make a dream at all. Mm-hmm. So we depend on kind of renewables. But the renewables are also very hard work. Based on the Zhongying's calculation, I give a little bit kind of detail, just to give him such warning for that. Renewable also is the big task. If we are have the kind of by 2030, by the 2030, if we are the non-fossil fuels, it's 20%. However, I think that hydro is limited, nuclear is limited. If we only rely on wind, solar, and biomass, that means we should have a 10 times higher generation compared to today. Within 15 years, 10 times, what's the percentage every year to increase? That's also a big challenge. Mm-hmm. So we hope renewable energy in China can be developed quickly and with large scale. That can make a Chinese carbon emission the peak time as early as possible, or as smaller as possible. That's rely on renewables. If a renewable do a good job, they can get better situation of mm-hmm. carbon emission. The wise words.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. We have some time now to open up to questions in the audience. And I ask, there's people walking around with microphones, and if you could please tell us your name and identify yourself. Sir.
Yeah, hi, I'm Gordon Davidson. I'm the chairman of LightSense Technology, and we have some energy-related technologies. But the questions I have on the Chinese report as well as the DOE report has to go to utility-scale battery storage. Mm-hmm. And how that technology or suite of technologies have been factored into your analyses, the assumptions, technology improvements, and the cost.
Thank you. So the question is, you know, what type of storage assumptions do you have in your study? Zhongying, would you like to maybe start on that and turn it over to Sam? The role of storage.
The storage is about the cost is very difficult to justify. So we take another way. In our study, we also have the storage component. For example, by 2050, in our electricity, we should have to keep the almost 200 gigawatt storage, 1.6 or 1.7 hundred gigawatts storage. But I want to mention is very important. So far, we calculate the cost according to the electricity vehicle, the cost. So this is a very how to say, each normally in China, 200 kilometers is the or 40-45 storage is the kilowatt hours vehicles in renminbi about the how to say some $40,000 around $40,000 per car. That's have the 40 or 45 the storage kilowatt hours $40,000 per car. But I think your question very good. That's our next step. Work. We will do the more detailed analysis about energy storage, electricity vehicle that influence influence our power system. This is we also need to change our model, some of the parameters.
Yeah. It's always more to do.
Yeah.
Sam, did you want to add anything on the U.S. study?
Yeah, for the U.S. study, we did look at storage. We were only looking at the bulk system. We were not looking at this distribution system. So in the bulk system, with a build-out, particularly of wind and solar, and added up to on the order of, in the high penetration scenarios, about half of all U.S. capacity, geothermal, biomass, hydro, and others filled in the rest. And with that, we typically required the system model chose to put in on the order of 100, 150 gigawatts of storage. And that was typically in the form of pumped hydro or compressed air energy storage. Batteries at the bulk level were too expensive to be picked up by the model. Now, we did not do the distribution system. And I expect on distribution systems where you have a lot of rooftop solar and other kinds of systems down at the rooftop level, that battery storage, like the Chinese study with electric vehicles or stationary battery storage, is going to play a more important role. One of the reasons you don't see as much storage as has historically been expected is because, again, these technologies, these resources are complementary, wind at night, solar during the day, so that they tend automatically, with a wide area to draw from, they tend to smooth out their supply. And so transmission is also important, but not critical within this.
Great, thank you. Other questions?
Hi, thank you for the informative talks. I am Jackie Liu from Brookings Institutions. So I have two questions. The one is in terms of the electricity market. What is your comments on the number 9 document, 9号文件, and what do you think is the biggest challenge to come to for the reform? And the second one is, what is the role of nuclear in this roadmap? Thank you.
Maybe if you could just briefly say what this is for people who are maybe not familiar in the audience, the number 9.
The number 9 documents is a document for electricity reform that released by Chinese government.
Yes. Thank you.
I think the Chinese government has announced the kind of electricity system reform. I think this does the guidelines. This does give the kind of directions. It's the kind of decentralized, market-based. That's the principle. But they needed quite a lot of details, regulations to be published. Recently, NDRC and with the relative departments of the government gradually to publish the kind of detailed regulations. However, I think, as you know, the power system is too complicated, especially like the country like China, such big. You couldn't rely on the one of the documentation can solve all the problem. Even we need to find the problem by the kind of demonstration, like Shenzhen, we have taken up a year-round kind of demonstration already. We found some problems. But after the kind of the release, the reform documentations, some new things, new problems are also coming. They also need to improve. So I think this is a good direction, but we need time. Also, we need, that's very important for the basis of the reform, stabilization of the kind of power supply during the kind of system reform. No one can do the test without kind of stabilization of the power supply. So that's the key issues. I think that to be patient, don't hope the one documentation can change everything, but we need the kind of timing. I think you might personally speaking that that's good direction. That's the only word that I can tell you. But we need timing for to have a complete the kind of a completion of such kind of reform.
Thank you. Zhongying, do you want to speak briefly about the role of nuclear power in this study?
In our studies, we fix the nuclear power scenarios. By 2050, we fixed the 100 gigawatt for the new power. Because our study is focused on high rational renewable energy. So we don't take more time for how much nuclear power, the nuclear power that's reasonable or not. We just fix the date. According to the present China, most of the nuclear power exports there, and also include our adjustings. We just focus on coastline, how many. But this, if from my own view, I don't think that our 100 gigawatt is possible. I don't know. Maybe after 2020, have nuclear power about have some of the new technology happen. If they have the new technology happen, maybe 200, 300 also possible. But so far we cannot see.
Interesting. Thank you. I know we're almost out of time, but maybe we can do another quick question.
Thank you. I'm a member of the Citizens Climate Lobby here in DC. So a little bit introduction about CCL. So what we're doing is we're trying to lobby the representatives of each district to introduce a policy that put a carbon price and a dividend. We don't call it carbon tax because it's different from tax. It's a fund. We collect the fund and then to increase the price of carbon, of fossil fuel. And then we'll distribute the fund back to each household. And this is in the U.S. and in the to make the product in the U.S. more competitive. So, like internationally, we will impose tag. So just the thing what we're doing. So like we know that in China, NDRC plays an important role in making policies. So what kind of public policies do you think NDRC can introduce in China and internationally to make renewable energy more competitive and affordable? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry to rush you. We're just almost out of time. Maybe Li Zhengfeng, could you speak a bit about carbon policies as well as maybe forthcoming renewable energy policies?
Yes, China promoting the development of renewable energies, they tried everything, the multiple policy, the kind of integrations. You can find any kind of policy instruments in any country that will be used in China. For example, the USA fixed tariff is used in China. Subsidies, yes, we use it in China. RPS also proposed in China. Also almost everything. So they try everything. But I think if the only things they do not adopt it is the carbon tax. I'm not sure this is useful or not. Currently, they have so many kind of promotion measures already. If we need a duplication or not, that's quite important. Even inside of China, some of the duplications already happened. For example, you get subsidies. For example, for the PV power generation, you get 52 Chinese cents per kilowatt hour already. Do you can get the green certificates for carbon trading, or you get the kind of carbon taxi, the kind of avoid or not? If we do that, this is really the kind of duplications for subsidies. They should be careful for the kind of policy instruments. Since the currently already by the subsidy, the wind and the solar is the protocol already. So we need a further kind of subsidies through the kind of carbon tax others. So be careful for that.
Great, thank you very much. Well, I'm afraid we are over time, or otherwise I would love to continue the conversation. Before we wrap up, I just wanted to thank again Resources for the Future for hosting this event, to the Energy Foundation for funding, I think, this really important study, and to our panelists for participating, and particularly our Chinese colleagues for coming to Washington today to tell us a bit about this report. And if you haven't picked up a copy, we still have them available. So thank you all very much.